Hi all, welcome back to my channel. It's been a while. Life has been hectic and it's been difficult to find time and the clarity of mind to present another tech topic in a coherent manner. But the recent events are too interesting to not at least try. I am sure you all have seen the launch of NVIDIA's RTX Ampere GPUs. It's one heck of a generational leap. Jensen and the team have to be congratulated. While Jensen did a great job at being a salesman in his presentation, the architecture details are still unknown at this stage. NVIDIA has not published a white paper for the consumer version of Ampere yet, and since GP100 in Pascal, the Tesla version is quite different, so we cannot draw too many parallels from the GA100 Tesla white paper. Compared to RTX TURING, the biggest change in RTX Ampere is the redesign of the streaming multiprocessor, or SM. You may have seen the doubling of CUDA cores and the corresponding increase in FP32 teraflops. Yet Jensen quickly glossed over it during the launch presentation, without going into any details. This led me to think about how it would be implemented, why it was implemented, and the implications such a change has for current and future gaming performance. Firstly, a disclaimer. What I present is based on research and my own understanding, which is not the full picture and therefore I could be wrong. But to get started, are the doubling of FP32 cores real? Simple answer, yes. Long answer, depends. What is more important is that we should shift our focus away from shader counts and instead look at the SM and the AMD equivalent compute units, or CUs. It is more accurate to refer to these units as the real cores of a GPU, as they contain the required resources to schedule and process work threads. To get into further details, we will first look at the SM design of consumer Pascal and Turing. In Pascal, each SM consists of 4 partitions of 32 ALUs or CUDA cores that can perform FP32 or integer 32 operations, for a total of 128 FP32 or INT32. Turing changed the SM partition to have 16 FP and 16 INT ALUs that can operate concurrently, for a total of 64 FP32 and 64 INT32 operations. There are two main reasons behind this change in Turing. First, in graphics workloads, there is a mixture of FP and INT operations, with INT ranging from 10 to 50%, on average around 25% of the total workload. In Pascal and older GPUs, when INT ops are running, the entire partition of 32 ALUs are locked in INT operation mode. Even if the integer operation is a small one that uses few ALUs, it prevents the rest from contributing to FP32 performance. It's important to note that while INT ops average to around 25%, it is spaced out in the pipeline and does not occur as a large chunk, but many tiny ops. As you can imagine, this led to a major drop in Pascal's SM occupancy, with many ALUs idling during small INT operations. The second reason for the change is, with fewer ALUs, it is easier for a broad range of workloads outside of gaming to keep them constantly busy. The fewer ALUs also share in the same pool of 256 kilobytes of registers, and this makes them individually faster for complex operations. An interesting side effect is that Turing SMs look very similar to the compute units in GCN, in terms of shader optimization, where register availability can be a bottleneck. This resulted in Turing running console-optimized games very well with minimal driver support. While the Turing SM have half the FP throughput, by running INT ops concurrently, its potential performance is higher than half a Pascal SM. The transistor savings from the reduction of FP ALUs was used to pack on more SMs, with the flagship RTX Turing more than double the SM compared to the flagship GTX Pascal. Despite this, it was only 35% faster in games at 4K. As you may know, the pipeline in graphics has other bottlenecks such as geometry, rasterization, and ultimately, memory bandwidth to feed the SMs is vital, particularly at high resolutions. Turing had a big increase in SMs, but it had a smaller increase in rasterization and bandwidth, hence it scaled poorly. Of course, it also brought first-gen RTX features, which I will discuss later. Overall, you could say Turing is a very compute-focused design intended for the HPC and the AI markets. Moving on to Ampere, the consumer RTX Ampere SM takes the Turing SM and replaces the small INT32 ALUs with a large dual-purpose FP32 or INT32 ALU. It essentially adds back a partial Pascal SM design, but this time with finer granularity, as each SM partition has 2 independent pipelines of 16 FP32 ALUs and 16 FP32 or INT32 ALUs. In total, the SM within the RTX Ampere can perform 128 FP 32 ops, or a mix of 64 FP and 64 in ops. With the concurrent execution capability, small in ops no longer stole the entire partition from FP processing, as the separate 16 FP ALUs can still continue working. The goal is to maximize ALU uptime within the SM, and this is one of the major reasons why NVIDIA made this change. Note that the side effect of the new SM is the ALU to register ratio no longer matches GCN in the consoles. As such, NVIDIA would have to keep up with driver optimizations for console ports to extract peak occupancy. This shouldn't be a problem though, as NVIDIA has a huge and capable software team. The other major reason why NVIDIA went with this design relates to ray tracing performance. RTX GPUs have RT cores that accelerate the task of tracking the ray path as it travels in the scene, something that's referred to as bounding volume hierarchy or BVH traversal. The other steps are done on the FP32 ALUs, and they involve calculating triangle intersections, set up the next ray bounds and travel calculations, and also denoising to improve the quality without a high increase of rays casted. We can refer to a diagram Jensen presented to understand the process better. In a single RT frame, a huge portion of the workload is the repetitive RT operations. During the RT step, the FP ALUs are busy keeping up with the BVH data generated by the RT cores. As such, any increase in BVH processing requires more FP ALUs to boost RT performance. Given that Jensen stated that the RT cores in RTX Ampere doubles the BVH acceleration, there has to be a corresponding increase in FP32 performance to prevent bottlenecks. Another interesting change in Ampere is the relocation of the render operators, or ROPs, to within the GPC, as opposed to being separate and linked to the memory controllers. This change allows NVIDIA to harvest and segment their GPUs better, giving them the flexibility to disable a memory controller or ROPs separately. A bonus of this layout is it should enable async compute workloads that are ROP dependent to run in parallel with the rest of the SM, giving them a performance speedup where such tasks are scheduled to run concurrently. On the topic of async compute, it should be noted that since Volta, NVIDIA improved the hardware scheduler to better handle mixed workloads. With Ampere, the scheduler and SM is able to concurrently run graphics, RT, and tensor cores. This, of course, is not a free lunch. It will cost additional transistors and hence increase power usage. In the immediate future, this means tensor-accelerated DLSS should run much faster, and in the near future, expect to see more NVIDIA GameWork effects that utilize tensor cores. Because once NVIDIA GPUs become good at something, you can bet your horse that Jensen is going to heavily push it and to maximize their advantage. As an architecture, RTX Ampere has gained far more compute than geometry, rasterization, or texture performance. Fortunately, it also has a large increase in SM cache bandwidth and memory bandwidth to keep these extra CUDA cores busy. Overall, it should provide a strong performance leap at high resolution, where the extra FP32 performance makes a bigger difference, or having a smaller gain at low resolution where ALU occupancy may suffer. Importantly, the more compute-heavy a game engine is, the better RTX Ampere scales. With the first-gen RTX Turing, I felt that RT and DLSS were not yet relevant, as early access features that are not supported by the wider ecosystem will rarely be implemented. However, with second-gen RTX, this all changes. Moving forward, no GPUs can be considered competitive if it has weak ray tracing or lacking in a high-quality upscaling feature. In terms of graphics, RTX Ampere is a very unbalanced design, but in the new era of compute-heavy shaders in games and ray tracing going mainstream in the next-gen consoles, it is in my opinion the correct design choice. My only concern is with the relatively low VRAM capacity, as we are on the precipice of a massive spike in next-gen gaming requirements. Perhaps soon, Jensen will also announce a refresh with more and faster memory. Finally, if RTX Ampere was produced on a better node process, AMD would struggle to remain competitive. But on Samsung 8N, though Jensen has at least chosen to pass on the savings to gamers, he also left open the possibility of AMD challenging RTX Ampere with RDNA 2. But that topic is for another video. I've started up a Patreon account, and if you enjoyed my content and would like to tip me a coffee or a beer, I'd be very grateful. Thank you, and see you all again next time.